from the WGN Newsroom. This is WGN News Now.
Good afternoon. Happy hump day. I'm Christine Flores.
Or is it Friday Eve Eve?
No, not yet.
Sorry. Well, anyways, I'm Chip Brewster. Welcome to the 3 o'clock edition of WGN News Now.
Taking a look at our top stories, that suburban chemical plant fire near Rockford continues to burn at this hour. Now, Illinois environmental officials are asking the state attorney general to look into filing charges in the explosion and fire.
The Chemtool plant in Rockton erupted in flames and thick black smoke Monday morning. Fire officials say the blaze could burn for several more days. Chemtool makes lubricating greases and industrial fluids, but investigators say they haven't yet figured out what triggered the blast. They're asking people in the area to be patient. Now, the mask ordinance in the 3-mile radius has been lifted, but the evacuation order with a 1-mile radius of the plant remains in effect.
Gun violence has shattered more lives in the city. Overnight, 9 people were shot on Chicago streets, 2 of which have died. 5 of those injuries happened in a shooting around 10 p.m. near Monroe and Hamlin in West Garfield Park. A man in his 30s suffered a critical gunshot wound to the leg. 3 other men and a woman are in good condition with lesser wounds. No word yet on what started it.
Juneteenth is now an official state holiday here in Illinois.
And today, it brings me exceptional pride that in a few moments I will sign into law the declaration of Juneteenth as a formal state holiday in Illinois, making us one of the few states in the nation to give it the full status that it deserves.
Governor Pritzker signed the legislation today that makes Juneteenth a full paid state holiday. That means that when workers are on when June 19th falls on a weekday, workers will have the day paid off. The state will also lower all flags to half staff every Juneteenth. That includes a Juneteenth flag, which will fly over the state capitol in Springfield. Illinois is now the 5th state to make the holiday a paid day off, and this Juneteenth is on a Saturday, next year on a Sunday, so it is June 2023 that we will see that first true paid holiday.
Chicago police are searching for the person who defaced one of the lion statues outside of the Art Institute. Graffiti was discovered on the lion's back shortly after 9 last night. Investigators say nothing else was damaged. Area 3 detectives are investigating.
Well, Bears fans got some great news today. The team announced that Soldier Field will open up this season at 100% capacity. This comes a year after no fans were allowed at the venue to watch the team's 8 home games. The Bears will host their first preseason game against the Dolphins on Saturday, August 14th, then open up their regular season schedule against the Bengals on Sunday, September 19th. Between the preseason and regular season, the Bears will have 10 games at Soldier Field from August through January. Now, when the Bears play in front of fans for the first time late this summer, it appears that a veteran will be under center for the team.
Now, our Larry Hawley has more on where the team's quarterback situation sits before players take a quick summer break.
There is one fact about the upcoming season that the Bears are pushing hard over the last few months. Andy Dalton said it after he was signed. Ryan Pace reinforced it soon after. And Matt Nagy has mentioned it a few times this offseason. The fact that Andy Dalton is the Bears' number one quarterback to start the 2021 regular season. This still has not changed for Nagy, even as it remains a topic with first-round pick Justin Fields in the fold. When asked this week if it is indeed true that Fields has no shot of beating out Dalton to start week one, Nagy had this to say.
Yes, correct. Andy Dalton is our starter, and when we go through this process, they're, like I said today, just calling a play in the huddle, and that gets to the instant gratification part that we all want, right? I understand that. Andy understands that. Justin understands it. Nick understands it. Our coaches understand that we all get excited about Justin Fields. You know, we'd all be lying if we said something different. But that said, we're excited about Andy Dalton too.
How long that will last past that week one start against the Rams on September 12th is to be seen. Fields figures to push him once training camp begins in July, serving as Dalton's primary backup with Nick Foles as the third stringer. And Nagy believes that each quarterback understands where they sit as offseason workouts come to an end and training camp approaches in July.
They know their roles, and now it's their job to be able to be the best quarterback they can be. But I'll just be very clear. That being said, does that mean that these guys aren't competing? Absolutely not. They're competing. Like, they want to be the best. And so, and they wouldn't want each other to not be any different.
And as they approach their rookie season, it's important to remember that the veteran Dalton and the rookie Fields have the same challenge. That's learning Matt Nagy's offense. Since this will be their first year in it, they'll have all a training camp, then 3 preseason games to get ready for that opener, September 12th against the Rams. Larry Hawley, WGN News Now.
Thanks so much, Larry. Time now for a quick check of your weather. Look at this beautiful day out there, Chip. Now we're taking a look at this camera over there, showing our museum campus. Now definitely take advantage of these temperatures, because that humidity, like Chip is about to tell you, is on its way back.
Hopefully there are people out there at the museum campus, out in Grant Park, as you said, just really taking advantage. So highs across the area. Chicago was expected around 76 today, 77 out in Columbus, but look into the west. Yeah, I'm pretty sure you can figure out why we're giving you a little prelude as to what we could expect. Dew points for today, guys, were amazing. Upper 30s, low 40s. Compare that to just 24 hours ago when they were 16 degrees higher as far as the dew point is concerned. In O'Hare, 15 higher in Joliet. So we really dried out, and that ushered in what a beautiful day we've had.
Yeah.
Today.
All right, moving into that forecast today, you see there, sunny Thursday, hot, and Friday, look at that, 92 degrees and also hot.
Whoa.
A trio of young ladies from Naperville were some of the first girls to join the Scouts BSA, and now they're among the first class of female Eagle Scouts. Eagle is the highest rank for a Scout, and only 5% of all Scouts earn the ranking.
But these determined ladies from Naperville, who are both sisters and then cousins, set out to earn their badges together. They join us now to tell us about that journey and that monumental achievement. I mean, those that have been involved in Boy Scouts for years know it takes a lot to make it to that rank of Eagle Scouts. So
congratulations.
My applause off the bat. Yeah. So why don't we start with Olivia. Why don't you tell us a little bit about deciding to go on this journey?
Yeah. So our uncle, Claire's dad, is actually the Scoutmaster of Troop 100. And when girls were first allowed to join Scouts BSA, he came to Grace and Claire and offered them to join. And I just kind of tagged along. So
that is awesome. Now, how long did it take you guys to get to this point?
So I'm the oldest of the three of us. And so I only had about 18 months to complete my Eagle before my 18th birthday, which is when you age out.
Oh,
wow.
I did get an extension, but I didn't want to use it because I felt like I needed to get it before my 18th birthday. So Claire and Olivia and I worked side by side to get it done in 18 months, I think, is what we got it in.
Wow.
I was impressed to begin with, and then 18 months to get there. So let's talk through some of those requirements for those that aren't familiar with just what it takes to become an Eagle Scout. I mean, I know there's a whole host of merit badges, mm-hmm. but that's not all, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so there are, Chris, I can't remember, 7 different ranks?
Yes, 7 ranks.
7 ranks that you have to go through, all have different requirements, like physical, community requirements, different things like that, first aid. You have to go through all 7 ranks of those. You have to get 21 merit badges, including some Eagle required ones. And you also, one of the big things is to do an Eagle project, which is something that helps your community in some way, shape, or form.
Wow. So what are some of those projects, or that big project that you guys decided to do?
Yeah, so what I did is I worked with a local teen center called the Alive Center in Naperville, and they have this really awesome art room with a lot of supplies for kids to use, but the floor of it was just kind of gross, had paint splatters all over it. So I used a machine to wash that floor, and then I repainted it, and someone came in to do a mural on it, and it turned out super awesome.
Wow.
Wait, so you each had to do an individual project? You didn't get to all 3 work on one?
No, we had to do an individual
one. Oh, okay, wow. There's a shot. That's that floor project, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so what are the other 2 projects?
Yeah, and so then I started my project, and I did my project in June of last year, so it was in the height of the pandemic. So an important thing to help out the community was we needed blood drives because there's such a big blood shortage in our community. So I decided to host a blood drive with the Versailles Blood Bank, and we were able to collect first-time donors was my main goal because there's lots of kids in my age that hadn't donated before. I just wanted to get people involved in the community to come out of the house and donate blood to help out.
Wow. And then what was that last project, the third project?
I did a food and supply drive for DuPage Pads, and we were able to collect over $2,000 worth of food, supplies, and different things that the homeless at DuPage would possibly need.
Congratulations, all three of you. That is amazing. Now, you guys are among the first class nationwide to earn this kind of a ranking. Were you guys ever nervous? I mean, to this day, do you ever feel like, I don't know, some kind of nervousness? Or are you just proud to wear those badges? I mean, as you should.
Yeah.
I don't think we were ever nervous. We joined our troop, and our troop was very accepting right away. We're one of a few linked troops where our sister and brother troops work together the whole time, so we have the same leadership. So we have our SPL, or it's our senior patrol leader, helps lead both troops, so that we're already co-mingled. So basically, it was just an easy transition since we already had older Boy Scouts to help us through our first couple months where we weren't quite sure what to do. So I don't think we were ever very nervous going into it. We were just very determined to get through it.
Nice.
Okay, one last question for you guys, and I'd love to hear from each of you on this. For any girls out there that they've heard about Boy Scouts being open to females, what would you say to them to encourage them to just take the leap and give BSA a try and strive for their own Eagle merit badge, or excuse me, Eagle rank, Eagle Scout rank?
I would say that if you're worried that you have to act like a boy to join Scouts BSA, that is not at all true. You can still be a girly person, you know, and still be a spinning image of a scout.
Okay.
I know when I first joined, I was just nervous about the environment. I'm not a very confident person, but you should have no hesitation to join Scouts BSA because it truly has helped me become a leader in both my troop, my community, and my school. And Scouts BSA really just instills in kids these really important characteristics that really make a person.
That's awesome.
Yeah. And I think it's important that if you want to get involved, get involved, because you never know who you're going to meet and all these friends that you're going to be lifelong friends with now that you have a connection through scouting with.
That is amazing. Ladies, once again, congratulations.
Yes, absolutely.
Because that is hard work, dedication, lots of hours that went into all this, too.
And in quite an amazing amount of time, too.
Yes.
The fact that only 18 months? Wow.
Yeah. Well, thank you guys so much for joining us. We do appreciate it, and we're going to leave you guys here with some more images of the project and the work and hours of dedication that they put in to earn these badges and earn this ranking. Calling all you fudge lovers, today is your day. Not only is it hump day, but it's also fudge day.
Our Tom Barnes is live at the Fudge Pot to help us celebrate this very sweet treat. So, Tom, I imagine you got several visual delicacies lined up for us.
I do. I just wanted to give you a shout or a shot of the outside, mm-hmm. just because it's kind of an old school candy shop right here in the Old Town neighborhood.
Yeah, very classic-like.
Where you can, yeah. Yeah, I'm going to just show you how you, when you walk in, look at this.
Oh, you can watch them make it all.
Yeah, that's right here. And you
that probably smells
in.
So good in there right now.
Oh, yeah, it's not terrible at all. This place is it's family owned since 1963. So I'm just going to make my way in here right now and try not to fall down the stairs. And I'm going to talk to my friend James, right?
Hi there. Yes, my name's James Dottolo.
James, and you are third generation of the Fudge Pot here in Old Town, started by your grandfather, your dad, and you are all doing this together. The picture right here is kind of how it sums it up, right?
Yep, that's right. I'm right here with my dad cooking up a batch of chocolate fudge today.
Fantastic. So when you walk in, I noticed that you don't see fudge right away. You see chocolate. So, guys, this is more than just a fudge place. They have all sorts of chocolate. James, why don't you just run through the gamut here of what you guys offer before we see the fudge making process here?
Well, we started with just fudge, but now we do a little bit of everything. Lots of good chocolate treats, cherries. We make our own pretzels, dip Oreos. We make our own toffee. Chocolate-covered strawberries fresh every day.
Do you guys have a favorite that you want me to show you? Do you have anything in particular that you want me to focus on here? I mean, I can bring something back to the station.
Good,
I'm just saying.
Like a chocolate or fudge-covered
Oreo. The chocolate toodles that you're looking at right now, the strawberries are two of our better
sellers. Chocolate Oreo. They were asking about chocolate Oreo.
We're right about to do a pour.
They're about to do a pour. You know what? We're going to skip the formalities, guys. We're going to go right to the chocolate or the fudge pour. And, James, when we get a second, this is the bowels of the place. Yeah, so here's some fudge that they have laying out right here, but I don't want to miss this spot because they've been waiting for us. And then James is going to explain to me at some point the difference between fudge and chocolate, which I don't know, but we're going to get that in a second. But what's happening right here?
Right now we're just trying to hit our temperature for our fudge. We're turning the flame down and just trying to get it nice and agitated and perfect right before we pour it onto the table.
It's almost like an oxymoron, nice and agitated, right?
Oh, nice and agitated is perfect right here.
So, James, this is your dad, right?
This is my father, David. That's right.
Hi, David. So this is all a family affair. You guys work together. How's that working out for you guys?
Actually, we're fourth generation candy makers. My great uncle invented the Milky Way bar.
Ooh, what?
But
your great uncle invented the Milky Way bar.
That's right.
You just kind of dropped that in like you said, hey, do you want ketchup on your hot dog?
He was Mars's very first employee.
No kidding. Wow. And here you are now doing your own thing here. That's
what we're looking at. My father involved. My father got me involved here, and here we go with the fourth generation.
All right, so I don't want to get in your way here. So where's the best way for me to stand, guys? Here.
Where's that coming from?
Yeah, I'm just going to show. What do we have going on here?
This is cream fondant, and that's Fondex. One helps solidify it, and one helps set it up.
Oh, okay. I had no idea.
Interesting.
So I'm probably right in your way.
All the way at the end,
because it's going to be nice and hot, right, guys?
Tom, get in the corner.
Whoa.
Yeah. Holy cow. This is like high.
All right, look at that.
So what is exactly are we seeing here, guys?
Right now, this is the fudge before we cream it. We just cooked it up to a nice 236 degrees. And we need to let it cool off on our stainless steel table down to about 190 degrees before we start beating it and turning fudge into fudge.
Wow. What is fudge? What's the difference between fudge and chocolate?
Let's come back over here. Cause
yeah, I'm following you. This is your show. I'm just sitting here. So they're just making stuff as we go, guys, right here. But James is going to give me a tutorial on fudge. So, James, what do we have here?
So, difference between fudge and chocolate. Fudge can just be a vanilla type of thing, or it can be a chocolate type.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Fudge is, chocolate to fudge is more like an ingredient, like chocolate cake is chocolate's an ingredient to the cake.
Who knew?
Okay.
So, chocolate's just kind of that ingredient to make fudge. We're combining syrups and milk fats and sugars, all that good stuff, cooking it up nice and high,
all the good things,
and then agitating it and beating it on a table to promote the crystal growth so that you have a nice...
Yeah, why don't you cut a piece, right? You guys, we should try one. I mean, you guys can do this through the smell-o-vision of the app here, but you guys have been, you've been in business since 1963, started off with the fudge, and you've grown since then, right? So you have all this chocolate. I want to show just real quick. They have a ton of stuff here, guys. Look at this.
Ooh, look at that
Tom,
menu.
They have,
keep in mind that we are streaming to the world. So a question's already come up is, do they ship? And if so, how far?
James, there are people wondering who are watching, do you guys ship? And how far do you ship if you do?
We do ship, but I'm not a big fan of shipping in the middle of the summer because it's kind of hot.
That's legit.
Yeah, especially tomorrow, probably not a good day to leave it in your car, right?
Yep. It's a little hard to...
But in the wintertime, yes?
Oh, in the winter, absolutely.
What would be the best way for people to go about doing that?
To place a shipping order?
Yeah.
Come September, October, once the temperature starts to drop a little bit.
Uh-huh.
You could just go to our website, www.thefudgepotchicago.com, and we have an easy online checkout once we turn it back on for the season.
And is that your busy time, would you say?
Oh, it's absolutely our busiest time. National Fudge Day comes in the middle of the summer because it's probably our slower period of time.
Yeah, this is slow, guys. I've been here for 2 minutes, and there's been people waiting in line patiently for their fudge as these guys are just humming along here, and they have other things, too. They have hard candy. James, you want to talk about this hard candy real quick before we get out of here, just because I think it'd be a shame not to talk about everything you guys have going on here.
Well, the hard candy was one of the first things after fudge that we started making, followed quickly by caramel.
Those are huge.
You know, it's just fun to introduce fun flavors.
Yeah, they're massive, right, Kai? Like, I mean, here you go.
Oh, wow.
Just so you don't forget.
Yep, and we do our own personalization. You can generally come in or order a lollipop to say whatever kind of message you want to say.
Very cool. And I just want to point out real quick again that this space they've had since the beginning. It's time to go back. All right. One more thing, guys. We got a final process of the fudge. It's cooled off.
Okay.
But they've owned this building, or they've owned this space the entire time, and they expanded over the years into this space that we are now right outside of where I kind of showed you. This is the window. And what are we going to see here, fellas?
Are we set and ready to go?
Yep. Okay.
This is the next phase of the fudge creaming process. Once it's cooled down a little bit, we need to stimulate the fudge and get its crystals to grow a little bit, and we do that by beating it.
Okay, so you're going to beat it and agitate it again,
it,
huh? So this is how it started. So go for it. I'm going to watch it.
The parody of that song is Eat It. So it works well.
There you
also.
Go.
Yeah, a little Weird Al for sure,
exactly.
Right?
You can see how hot and molten that was before, and now it, it's kind of kept its form.
Is it weird that I just want to lay down on top of
it? Oh, yeah, guys. I mean, this was boiling.
Okay. Go ahead, you can.
I would accept trying it.
We work it.
So they're just removing the, what would you call this that's holding it in place?
Very heavy steel beams.
It's oozing.
Is what I would call
it.
Get it back on the table, move it around to aerate it, and cool it off a little bit more.
So this is part of agitating it again.
Mm-hmm. Yep, this is all part of cooling it down so that it can take its final shape.
And how long does this process go on for?
Oh, this takes maybe 10 minutes.
Now we're getting serious. Look at this. Well, I'm going to swing around here if that's okay.
Ooh.
James, you want to follow
that
me
agitation.
Here? So this is... Yeah. Wait, what's with the marshmallows back there?
That is fondex and fondant, kind of like fondue and fondant. Oh, those.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Those are going to be chocolate marshmallow walnut fudge.
Oh, sorry.
We're splitting this part chocolate plain, and the other part will be chocolate marshmallow walnut.
Oh,
that's
chocolate
delicious.
Marshmallow.
I want to.
Right?
You can't go wrong with that, right, guys?
Yeah.
No.
So you guys are going to do this for a little bit long, for another 10 minutes or so?
10 minutes until it's all set up, and then we get it in the pan, and it's pretty much ready to sell after
that.
Our last batch of fudge that we made about an hour ago is cooled and set right up on that ledge there.
Nice.
This is latest creation. It's a Snickers fudge.
Snickers fudge. So I'll just, guys, you're going to put your order and you're going to have to text me on the old Teams there. And I'll be sure to bring you guys something. It might melt, though. I don't know. So you might not get any. I don't know what to tell you guys.
It might just magically not make its way here.
Yeah.
Oh, fondant melt, not fudge.
Mouth. Well, if anybody out there wants to see
this
entire process,
no, you can get this right back to the station today without any trouble.
We've got the address at the bottom of the screen there, 1532 North Wells, and then the website up. So when they do turn the shipping back on, Brenda in Tampa, Florida, you can go to that website to get that ordered firsthand. Tom Barnes, another rough day on the job for you. Anything else that you wanted to add to celebrate Fudge Day today?
No, just I just wanted to, again, pay homage to the two generations here that are part of this business. Guys, what days are you open, just real quick?
We're open every day right at 12 o'clock noon, and generally we're open till at least 8 o'clock on Sunday through Thursday and 10 p.m. on
awesome,
Friday.
Awesome, we can go check them out afterwards.
All right, well, fantastic, guys.
Thank you so much, Tom.
Thanks,
well,
Tom.
I'll get those orders from you guys. Yep.
Okay.
No problem.
Snickers fudge. That's all I asked for. Bring back the snick. I don't know if you heard me. Snickers fudge. Anyways.
Now, today is also a special anniversary in Chicago movie history.
Hmm.
Everybody needs somebody. Everybody needs somebody to love.
It was. was on this date 41 years ago that this classic made its debut. Of course, we're talking about the Blues Brothers. They took us on a tour of Chicago's hotspots during Jake and Elwood's mission from God to save a troubled... Can you do that?
That was a good impression. No,
thank you. I've worked on it for 34 years of my life. Anyways, to save a troubled orphanage, its very first screening was actually a private showing in Norwich, and critic Gene Siskel, the one and only, proclaimed it, quote, the best movie ever made in Chicago.
I didn't know that.
And I completely agree with Mr. Siskel. 100%. Please tell me you've seen this movie.
Definitely a classic. I mean, if you haven't seen it, don't tell anyone.
That's
pretend
right.
That we didn't hear that. But otherwise, add it to your list.
So I had the story in the 1 o'clock, and I talked about my favorite Blues Brothers quote.
Okay.
Not to put you on the spot. It okay. was 106 miles to Chicago. I got a full tank of gas, half a pack of cigarettes. It's dark, and we're wearing sunglasses. Hit it. Okay, so that's why I had the...
Nice.
Anyways, that was my shtick in 1 o'clock.
You just need your fedora.
I know. I actually have it, too. I have a black fedora that I would have been nailing it today. I know where it is, too, in the closet at home.
It would have been on point.
I do Blues Brothers. So that's my karaoke go-to.
Oh, really?
It's a Blues Brothers song.
Oh.
Yeah. So if I'm feeling real, like, funny, I bring the fedora with me to the karaoke.
That's
and then
awesome.
People are either laughing with me or at me, but either way, everyone's having a good time. So that's my Blues Brothers story. I hope everyone enjoyed it. Let's move on. Let's get out of the Blues Brothers before I embarrass myself any further. All right, sneakerheads have another reason to rejoice this afternoon. Lego has partnered with Adidas to create a brick version of its original sneaker, the Adidas Superstar.
It includes the sneaker's 3 stripes and shell toe shaft. Plus, it even comes complete shape, rather. Plus, it even comes complete with shoelaces and a shoebox, but you can't wear them, obviously. The set is also sold with a display stand, further solidifying its place in the world of collectible products. The Lego Adidas sneaker has 731 pieces, and it will only set you back about $80.
Oh, okay.
It will be available July 1st.
I love that. It is a true Lego set that you can build.
Yeah, that's awesome.
But you know what they said? You can't wear it? That sounded to me like a challenge.
I mean, you can try it and see.
Someone's small foot can fit in there.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe
my 2-year-old daughter would wear it and destroy it in the process. But
I can already see all the pieces just flying everywhere.
So quickly, too. Oy vey.
No, that's really cool, though. Classic, especially for those who are collectible or, you know, aren't collecting. Well, not only sneakerheads, but who are into collecting Legos because they have so many different sets and you can make your own. And I know a couple of people who actually, like, this is one of their hobbies. And if you go down to their basement, it's like...
Lego sets,
yes,
it is. Oh, cool.
Yeah, and they some of them have even, like, created their own. And it's a thing in the Lego world where you can go online and you can trade pieces.
Ooh.
Or you can buy them off each other. And then that's kind of where, you know, the whole pricing comes in. It's a
Your
whole
knowledge
culture.
Of the Lego world is surprising me right
I've
now.
I've done several
this is
stories.
Super cool. Oh, okay.
I've done several stories on these, and they're actually pretty cool. So I'm sure that those who are into Legos and collecting them and, like, showing them off, there's actually, you know what? There's actually shows, like, kind of like trade shows that go on for Lego.
Like where you bring your piece
yes.
to the show?
Yeah,
kind of thing?
And so... people that I've interviewed before, they don't take everything apart completely because not only are they small, tiny Lego pieces, but they also have wires and things like that because some of them move.
Wow, that's intense.
It gets really intense. And there's even competitions
cool.
on them, too. So that also makes me wonder, like, where does this fit in the competition world in Legos? And is it just something that I keep on display? Or how much would it be worth later on?
I feel like, too, there might already be someone that's made something. Like, just based on what you're saying, how they come up with
their
own designs.
Oh, I wouldn't be surprised, because the things that I've seen them create that aren't even sold as sets through Lego, I'm like, what? Like, an entire Quidditch set for Harry Potter.
Oh, that is so cool.
With actual moving figures.
Like, they're flying around?
Yes, they're flying around.
Did you see the Snitch?
I can't remember.
That's okay. I bet it existed. You can't get to that level of detail and not have it somewhere on that. Anyways, we're going way... We went down a Lego rabbit hole. That was really cool. Well, don't worry. We've got one more story for you.
Yes. There's now an interesting way to grill burgers, and it's getting traction online. It involves ice cubes. Now, you'd cook the patties with an ice cube on top. Apparently, the cube prevents the burgers from overcooking in the middle, so they stay nice and juicy.
Interesting. So when I saw the slug for this story, I thought it was going to be something with Ice Cube, the man, the rapper.
Oh.
Like, it's a video of Ice Cube cooking, grilling burgers. No, Ice Cube for grilling burgers.
Have you heard of this?
I haven't.
I hadn't heard of this.
So KTLA's Tech Smart reporter, Rich DeMuro, was turned on to this method by a grill-savvy friend. So he says that it works great. So we've got a little firsthand information from one of our next star buddies out there in L.A.
Yeah.
I've never heard of this.
Interesting. Those of you tuning in, if you've heard of this or even if you tried it, let us know. Because we're both kind of like, what? Surprised by this is the fact that this is a thing.
But I totally want to, I'm interested, especially because, those kinds of burgers, especially where they're like pre-made thin patties, like I could never get them right on the grill. I always got to hand make mine so that way I know. That it's being done right, but very interesting.
And then also, too, because people can get picky, like, hey, I just want a little bit of pink, or, I don't want mine fully overdone.
So then you do, I'll do a little bit of ice for your more well-done burger.
Probably.
And then
I mean, I think
I would like a large ice cube on my burger, thank you.
Just add that on there.
Okay, no problem. We got a grill here at WGN. We can make it happen.
Yes. All right, let's take a look at these comments. What have people been saying?
So I've got a couple of comments already. Okay. They're all from Brenda. Brenda's been wonderful this entire time. But Christine, this one is for you.
Okay.
Have you been to Legoland? So there's one in Florida. There's also one
I've been to the one
California.
In California. Yes, I have. And that in itself is like amazing. It's pretty awesome, the things that they have there. And I want to say that they like rotate things out. So every time you go, it's not the same thing. But I have been to the one in California. I haven't been to the one
cool.
in Florida.
Okay, we got this comment early on when we were talking about what's been going on in Rockton with Chemtool.
Yes.
Casey, I drove by the explosion about an hour after the smoke, and it was about an hour after, the smoke was incredible, and the environmental impact will be long felt, they were saying. And again, that explosion was like 7 a.m. on Monday.
Yeah.
So it's been going on since
then. You can still see that smoke, definitely. We have some of our reporters who have been out there, and you can just still see the photos, and obviously we talked about how the evacuation order is still in effect, but not the mask.
Correct. Yep. They lifted the 3-mile radius mask ordinance, I think is what they were calling it, but not the 1-mile radius evacuation order. And I recall, too, the two press conferences that I helped stream today on WGN News Now, the environmental impacts are still being assessed also. Like, we still don't have definitive information on that yet. So it'll be interesting to see exactly what the results are when they actually have those figured out.
Yeah.
Here's another one for us.
Fudge, yum. Fudge. All right, so Karen is a fudge lover. Maybe. I don't know. Karen, do you have a particular like fudge that you like? Because it definitely looked good on there.
It did. And when he said Snickers, fun fact, Snickers is my favorite candy bar.
Ooh.
It might be then my favorite fudge. It's just kind of logical. You put those two things together.
It would make sense, right?
Yes. Taking a look through. Brenda made one other comment that because she was so awesome commenting on my Facebook page, I'll bring it up just to encourage. Love the Blues Brothers quote. It's my favorite one. I also did at the 1 o'clock just because she brought it up. Orange whip, three orange whips. That's another classic Blues Brothers. John Candy in the stands. Anyways, we feel like we've gone a little off the rails with Blues Brothers and Legos and stuff today, but it was a really good day. So a reminder too, if you're making some comments, we love bringing them in. We're really hoping people start using the hashtag #HeyWGN, #HeyWGN, just as a way for us to confirm that yes, you want this comment brought into the discussion.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Well, that does it for us this afternoon. Thank you so much for joining us. We will be back tomorrow beginning at 1 o'clock in English,
2 o'clock
in Spanish, and then 3 o'clock the both of us again.
Yep, so take care. Have a great rest of your day, and we will see you tomorrow.
Have a great one.